This is a summary of David Hume's essay entitled Of Miracles. And he's writing here against miracles, but what his actual argument is up for debate. At least scholars disagree. So let's just go ahead and dive into the text. He starts off with a principle of experience. And what he means by this is that wise people follow the evidence. Wise people proportion their beliefs to the evidence. And what he has in mind by evidence is personal experience on the one hand, all of our experiences in life and in the world, and human testimony on the other. He thinks that human testimony is essential to living. We can't get along by ourselves. We have to rely on other people all the time. But sometimes human testimony and our own personal experience come into conflict. There's a tension there. And so we have to do this balancing act to decide which one we should believe, to decide which one is superior. He says that sometimes other people share stuff with us, it's about marvelous events, it's things that we have no experience of whatsoever. And so what do we do in those cases? Well, he gives the example of the Indian prince who lived in the subcontinent and may have not had any experience of water freezing. Then one day he encounters a visitor from up north who shares this this idea that there's snow, there's ice, and the like. Hume thinks that the Indian prince would be rational in rejecting that claim because the prince has no experience of such things, even though, of course, there is such things in the world. He says that's one thing, but it's entirely a different thing when the claim that comes to your ears is about a miracle. And he defines a miracle here as the following. A miracle is a violation of the laws of nature. Now, this is actually only the first definition in the chapter, in the essay, of a miracle. The second one follows it down below in a footnote, and it says it is a transgression of a law of nature by a particular volition of the deity or by the interposition of some invisible agent. So what's the significance of these two definitions? Scholars debate this, so we'll leave that alone, or I'll let you research that on your own. What's the point of these two definitions? But he goes on to say that as a firm and unalterable experience has established these laws, the laws of nature, the proof against a miracle from the very nature of the fact is as entire as any argument from experience can possibly be imagined. And then skip down a few lines, he says, there must therefore be a uniform experience against every miraculous event. Otherwise, the event would not merit the appellation. And as a uniform experience amounts to a proof, there is here a direct and full proof from the nature of the fact against the existence of any miracle. So that's a pretty strong claim, and throughout history, at least the first 200 years, interpreters have taken that to be an a priori argument against the existence of miracles, and many of them have said that Hume's argument was persuasive and sound, but people continue to write about this, and so it hasn't been settled, I'll just say that. So is this an a priori argument? Well, the a priori argument would look something like this. The laws of nature are absolute and inviolable. A claim of a miracle or a miracle is a violation of the laws of nature. And so since that's impossible, there cannot be such things as miracles. So is that in fact his meaning? Is that in fact his argument? Well, in the next paragraph, he gives us a sort of admission. He says that no testimony is sufficient to establish a miracle unless the testimony be of such a kind that its falsehood would be more miraculous than the fact which it endeavors to establish. So this admission, he says, unless the falsehood of this testimony would be more improbable, then he seems to make it a possibility that a miracle claim could be true. At least it's a logical possibility. And if it's a logical possibility, we don't have an a priori argument here. So I think that's evidence to show that that's not actually what Hume is claiming here. Moreover, in part two begins by him saying that what he's just done in part one was actually a bit too generous, that he's been too liberal. And so now he wants to make an even stronger argument. But keep in mind, an a priori argument is about as strong as you can get. So if he's got a stronger argument, it's got to be another a priori argument, or we've misunderstood what he's had to say. And in fact, what follows is not an a priori argument at all, it's an a posteriori one based on his observations about human nature and the facts of human history. So let's look at that part in part two. First, he says, quote, "There is not to be found in all history any miracle attested by a sufficient number of men of such unquestioned good sense, education, and learning as to secure us against all delusion in themselves, of such undoubted integrity as to place them beyond all suspicion of any design to deceive others." And so what he's saying is that for all the miracle claims that have occurred in history, there haven't been either there haven't been enough witnesses, or the witnesses that there have been have not been of, quote, unquestioned good sense and education. Okay, second, he says that as a principle of human nature, we all have this love of wonder. We're attracted to things of wonder and mysterious things. He says, but if you can join that love of wonder with the religious impulse you find in us, he says you have to give up believing anything that follows. There's a good reason not to believe anything when wonder, the love of wonder and our religious impulses are conjoined. Third, he says that these miracle claims thrive or are abundant in human history, especially during or in ignorant and barbarous nations. Those are his words. And so for that reason, we modern enlightened people should reject such claims. That's his claim. Number four, he says that each claim is in competition with other claims. So each religion in the world claims certain miracles have occurred, and those miracles are allegedly supposed to support the truth claims of that religion and make that religion distinct from others. Well, as every religion has these miracle claims, these claims then cancel each other out, and so we end up believing none of them. He follows this with some stories of certain religious miracles, and then makes a very strong claim near the end. He says, but according to the principle here explained, the subtraction with regard to all popular religions amounts to an entire annihilation, and therefore we may establish it as a maxim that no human testimony can have such force as to prove a miracle and make it just a just foundation for any such system of religion. So these are strong words, entire annihilation. That word dwarfs any word he's used so far, even the word proof in the first part. And then following that, he admits that there may possibly be miracles or violations of the usual course of nature of such a kind as to admit of proof from human testimony, though perhaps it will be impossible to find such in human history. So he says it's at least possible that you could be justified in believing that a miracle has occurred, even on the basis of testimony. And he gives examples here of the 8 days of wonder, 8 days of darkness and the Queen Elizabeth resurrection. But then he follows that with this, but should this miracle be ascribed to any new system of religion? Men in all ages have been so much imposed on by ridiculous stories of that kind that this very circumstance would be a full proof of a cheat and sufficient with all men of sense, not only to make them reject the fact, but even reject it without farther examination. And so he seems to say that we cannot be justified in believing that a miracle has occurred on the basis of testimony if it's meant to establish a religion. And so he ends the essay with his true target, which is Christian religion and the miracle claim, the central miracle claim, which is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so then, what is his argument? What is his argument against miracles? Is it that a miracle is impossible? Is it that we are never justified in believing that a miracle has occurred? Is it that we are not justified in believing that a miracle has occurred on the basis of testimony? Or is it that we are not justified in believing that a miracle has occurred on the basis of testimony if it's meant to establish a new religion? Or it could be a combination of all of those. So I will just let you decide on what he has in mind.